I just pray that God will bless you as you join us on this Periscope, as well as watch it through other avenue, that God may give you the opportunity to do so. Question is, what is hot on your spirit, Pastor Dada, at a time like this? What did God put for you, you know, to share with the people of God? It is something that is very, very critical. Particularly, we are living at a time where there are multiplicity, diversity of religion, and all kinds of things that are, you know, pressurizing us. And we are wondering, some are even wondering, why Christianity? Why am I a Christian? What am I doing in the Christian fold? And so on and so forth. You know, there's so much talk about Jesus. Who is this Jesus? Where did he come from? And so on and so forth. I know. So that's what I want to throw more light on. To some, it may be something they are already conversant with, and I thank God for your life. But I believe there are coming generation, in this, particularly in this generation, who are just wondering, why this Jesus? Well, my topic is not why Jesus. My topic is actually, where did Jesus come from? And what has he come to do? Where did Jesus come from and what has he come to do? And I want to give 31 things he has come to do. There could be more, but that's what I felt led at this time to share. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I just want to thank you once again for the opportunity to bring your word to your people. I pray that, Lord, you will give me clarity of purpose. You will give your people understanding, and it will bless them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In John chapter 6, verse 38, the Bible says, Jesus speaking, "For I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me." I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. Verse 39, "And this is the Father's will which has sent me, that of all which he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which sees the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. The Jews then murmured at him, because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven." Wow. I know it's a big piece of pie, you know, to swallow, particularly at that time. You know, it's easier for us to comprehend now. But I can imagine, you know, knowing somebody born in a tropical hospital at one time, or born in my neighborhood, growing up in my presence, and coming up and say, "Look, you know what? Even though you saw me born in the hospital there, I didn't come from that place. I came from heaven." I think that was the challenge that the people were facing that time. You know, and if you have read John chapter 6 very well, you will notice that it started by Jesus feeding 5,000 people. And after he has fed them, the following day, you know, they were there again, gathered. In fact, they came earlier than him, and they said, "Look, oh God, you came late today." You know, and he was telling them, "You are not here because you want to hear me, or you want to hear about things that are heavenly and heavenly, you know, helpful to you. You are here because you saw a miracle of carnality of bread yesterday, and you are looking for more today." But he now went ahead to tell them, "I'm the bread of life." And the conversation went on and so on. And if you read through also, you find that, in fact, the Bible says at that point, some people, even his disciples, left him. Well, you don't need to leave him. Amen? Because the truth is that Jesus came from heaven. And it makes it clear that he came from heaven. And what also helps me is I've traveled to many nations to the glory of God. I've seen all kinds of religions being worshipped. I mean, people starting religion and so on. And the sources by which they come from, they tell us. And I can tell you, they are less credible. And they don't even have a proof of it. In the case of Jesus Christ, he did not just prove that he came from heaven. The Bible says he was killed. The Bible says he resurrected. The Bible says in the presence of the people, he took off. And you heard me reading that he kept talking about, I will raise him up in the last day. In other words, he's not just telling you about the fact that he came from heaven. He was showing us that he is in charge. Why was he concerned about telling us that he came from heaven? I give you three reasons that comes to my mind. It could be more. Number one, to authenticate his message. His message that there are going to be a lot of religion. I mean, he is God anyway. We anticipate that he knows the world. He's omniscient, omnipresent, omniscience. So he has all the powers. So he knows what is going to happen because he spoke 2,000 years ago in anticipation of what we are seeing right now. You know, so it is to authenticate the message that the message I'm bringing to you is not natural language. Message. It is a revelation. It is what God, the maker of the earth, has sent me to deliver to you. And you need to see it in that light because it was complex for them. Number two, I think to tell them about heaven. Everybody, every religion talks about going to heaven. But nobody knows this heaven. No other religion on earth has any information about heaven. Everything's about speculation. So, Jesus now says, if you people are going to end up in heaven, I came from heaven. I am credible enough to tell you about heaven. And number three, since we all know that we will end up in heaven, it is good for us to have some knowledge about it. Jesus came from heaven. Hallelujah. If you are looking for a religion whereby you want to serve God, look for a religion that knows its source and knows where it's going. I know some religion, they tell you this is where they, and you read their book, books of theology, and they tell you they don't know where they are going. But Jesus said, look, I came from heaven. I'm going back to heaven. In Acts chapter 1, let me just quickly read that and then we move forward quickly. Acts chapter 1, verse 11. And ye gazing up into heaven, this same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. That's part A of this message. Part 2 is, what did he come to do? What did he come to do? He said he came to do the will of his Father. The will of his Father. Let me ask you. I hope you have given your life to Christ. Are you doing the will of your Father? It makes it clear that it's not just from heaven. His Father sent him for a purpose. There is a purpose for him to come. One of the reasons we know by now is to save humanity. It doesn't matter how complex. It makes it clear, I have come to do the will of my Father. And imagine that the will of your Father is for you to be killed. For you to die. And this man went ahead and did it. May you do the will of your Father. And so what did Jesus come to do? Number one, and I'm giving you 31 very snappily and sharply, sharp, sharp, sharp. Amen. For I came down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. John 6:38. He came to do the will of God. Then he added, look, I have come to do your will. Hebrews 10:9. Number two, he came to save sinners. He came to save sinners. Pastor Dada cannot save you. Muhammad cannot save you. Buddha, Confucius, Hare Krishna, Ekan Khan, Orimula, Ogun, Oya, Hindu cannot save you. No matter how good your pastor is, he cannot save you. No matter how good your president, your prime minister, your PM, they cannot save you. They themselves need salvation. They need salvation. Only Jesus can save you. And that's why he came. That's why he came, to save sinners. Number Matthew 1:21 says, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. No denomination can save you. Christ Apostolic Church cannot save you. Redeemed Church cannot save you. Winners cannot save you. Methodists cannot save you. Pentecostalism, Evangelical, Charismatic, Methodism, whatever name, they cannot save. Only Jesus that came from heaven can save people who will go to heaven. I like 1 Timothy 1:15. Paul was speaking. He said, Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And he followed up, he said, of which I am chief. Pastor Dada, speaking to you today, I was a sinner. I can say, of which I am a chief. But he saved me. Hallelujah. He saved my life. He can save your life. He came to save us. He was born to save us from our sin, from evil, from the powers of darkness. Number three, he came to put away sin. He came to put away sin. Now, once at the consummation of the ages, he has been manifested to put away sin by the sacrifices of himself. By the sacrifices of himself. Hallelujah. He came to save us by the sacrifices of himself. Hallelujah. I pray that God will save you and help you in Jesus' name. 1 John 3:5. Hebrews 9:26. Now once at the consummation of the ages, he has been manifest to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. 1 John 3:5. You know that he appeared in order to take away sins. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. John 1:29. He didn't just come to save us. He came to take away the sin. You have a data bank for your sin. What does that mean for you? You have committed abortion. You have been an armed robber. You have done all the bad things. He has saved you. He doesn't keep your sin in archive. He actually says in Isaiah 43:25, I will forgive you your sins and I will remember them no more. Why is it important? A lot of people who have been saved, but because of the terrible things they did before they confessed Jesus as Lord, they hold themselves accountable to that. They can't move forward. They can't become pastor. They can't become a good wife. They can't become a good mother. They can't serve in the society. Something tells them, well, you committed abortion. Yeah, you stole money. You did this. Friend, Jesus came to save you and to take away your sins. Number four, to be our mediator, to stand between us and God, to mediate for us. Hallelujah. 1 Timothy 2:5-6, for there is one God and one mediator, between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Number five, our advocate is a similar terminology, but slightly different as much as possible. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Hallelujah. He came to be the advocate. That is John, 1 John chapter 2. Yes, 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Is your advocate. Is the one pleading. When the enemy comes to accuse you, well, you did this, you did that, even though you say you are a Christian, you told a lie yesterday, you didn't pay your tithe in full, you didn't say, I'm not encouraging you to do that, and wants to put the spirit of fear and condemnation instead of you moving forward, the Lord Jesus will come out in charge here. I paid my price for him. I gave my life to him. He advocates. He tells the Father your life better. The Lord bless you in Jesus' name. Number 6, he came to fulfill prophecy. I did not come to abolish, but to fulfill. Christ has become a servant to confirm the promises given to the Father. Romans 15, verse 8. Number 7, he came to fulfill. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. Think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy. In Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Jesus. For he is our peace and has broken down the middle wall, a partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandment, between one man, so making peace. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 13 to 14. You know what? John 1:17 says, for the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus. Moses brought the law. Jesus brought grace. And I tell you, grace is much, much better than the law. To keep what? The law. Number 8, he came. Are you here? You have never given your life, or you know somebody? Jesus is looking for you. I'm telling you, he's looking for you everywhere. Just amen. Luke chapter 19, verse 10. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Number 9, he came to us looking for you. He came to cleanse you, to purify you, and to save you. For the Son of Man has come to save that which. Number 10, he came to serve. It's such a challenge in our time for people to serve, either in the church or in the community, with integrity. You see people, they are put in place of trust as presidents, as governors, as senators, and all you do is what? Loot the place. Mess up the place. Jesus says, I've come to serve. For us to go back to basics in this Christianity, to develop the spirit to serve as a pastor. Yes, you heard me. Don't put yourself in position where you are not. Mark 10:45. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. Let's climb down. Sister, wife, brother, pastor, man, husband, parents, serve. Make that your philosophy of life. 11, he came to give his life as a ransom. Just as the man of God did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Matthew 20, verse 28. Number 12, I came that they might have life and have it more abundant. John 10:10. Salvation does not mean, yes, salvation does not mean suffering and sickness. We are going to suffer for him, but it makes it clear the devil will destroy. But I've come to give you life and that in abundance. As a Christian, you are entitled to a package of prosperity, a package of joy, a package of peace, a package of prosperity, living well. I've come to give you life and that in abundance. Number 12, it came that men might, they may have life and have it abundantly. John 10:10. Number 13, it came to reveal the Father. One know the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Matthew 11:27. Jesus said to him, he who has. John 14:9. How do we talk about God as we never seen? And that's part of why Jesus came and was telling us he's merciful. He doesn't want any man to be destroyed. He doesn't want us to go to hell. He actually wants us to. What happened, you know, in heaven, how Satan, you know, was arrogant and prideful, and he was thrown. now is too complex and too, you know, all kinds of things. And God is saying, look, you know what? I need somebody to escape. Number 14, he came to reconcile us and give us the ministry of reconciliation. The ministry of reconciliation. Many times, several years back, precisely 1987, we just started the ministry. I got married in 1986. I, you know, went to a place, the bush, to see the face of God. What do you want us to do? We have had so many things. Emphasizing the ministry of faith, about Derek Prince, ministry of deliverance, about Kenneth Copeland, ministry of prosperity, about Oral Roberts, ministry of healing, and so on. So, God, what do you want us to do? We wanted to know what God wants us to do. And after 3 days of praying and fasting, the Lord took us to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18. I have committed to your hand the ministry of reconciliation. Friends, and I think that's all that you see in the Bible. There's no ministry of deliverance or prosperity in the Bible. There's only one ministry, the ministry of reconciliation. Reconciling men to God and reconciling men to men. That's given us to do, to reconcile us. There was a bridge between us. There was a gap between us. I'm sorry, not a bridge indeed. And God brought a bridge through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And all things are of God, and has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. 5:18. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, we are sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now has he reconciled. Colossians 1, number 15. Deliver us from the power of darkness and captivity. Jesus came to deliver us from the power of darkness. You are a Christian. You have not known the Lord. This is the time for you to be delivered. God said to us this year is our year of deliverance and rest. And deliver us from the power of darkness. And translated us to the kingdom of his dear son. Number 16. Ooh, hallelujah. I'm excited. He came to redeem us. He came to redeem us. Are you redeemed? Redeemed. Jesus paid the price. Some people use their logic. How can somebody who died for you 2,000, who died on the cross in a place, yeah, that's why it is faith matter. That's why it is a faith matter. What you believe is what you get. I believe he died for me and he has transformed my life. I enjoy divine healing. I enjoy the goodness of God. Jesus has redeemed me. I'm no more walking in sin. No! I have a new life in me. I'm redeemed. I'm precious. I'm a holy nation. You are when you have embraced Jesus who came from heaven and is going back or has gone to heaven and is planning in one day. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Number 17, Jesus Christ came into the world to be a light in the world. John chapter 12 verse 14, I'm come a light into the world that whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. Jesus spoke to the people, come, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. John chapter 8, verse 12. Friends, Jesus is not just the light, he's also making you the light. I was preaching today in church and I was telling them, nobody reads the Bible. No, particularly the unbelievers. They don't read the Bible. They read you. What is in your Bible? So they expect you to live well, to be the light for them. Let's go and be the light. Don't be part of corruption. When you are a young boy, everybody's going to party. You are young, everybody's sleeping around, doing boyfriend. No, you are the light. Tell them that's not the way it works. Keep yourself pure until you are married. Don't have sex. Don't say, oh, the government gives you condoms. Condom to what? You are not yet in your career. You are planning parenthood. No, condom is not helping you to do anything. There are some things that they are giving. Please, live a life of light. Light to darkness. We are in a world that is full of darkness, sense of it. And you have heard the word of God. Jesus says, he has come. You are now the hand of Jesus. You are the leg. In that your office, shine light. Everybody's corrupt. Tell them, if there is one person in this office that is not going to be corrupt, it's going to be Amos Dada. If there is somebody in this office that will come in time, that will rely and do his work integrity with intelligence, That's how to be the light. 18, he came to preach. He said to them, I must preach the kingdom of God to this purpose. Luke 4:43. You know, we have the International Gathering of Eagles Conference, and we go every year to Singapore, to Malaysia, you know, so on and so forth. Friends, why are we doing that? We are doing what God wants us to do. That's what Jesus did. He was healing in one place. They said, oh, stay here. No, no form or the other that I've had and I embrace Christ. There is two-thirds, 67%. So don't just go to church and out. He has come to preach. We are the legs and the hands and the eyes and the personality of Christ. Number eight, yes, you heard him. He came to bring fire. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. He will burn up the shaft with 11 to 12. Hallelujah. He came to bring the Holy Ghost and fire. Hallelujah. There will be another time to talk about the Holy Spirit. So he has not received the Holy Spirit indwelling, as we said. He said, there is a zeal in me. I cannot. They were slapping him. There's a zeal in me. There is fire in my bones. The Holy Ghost in your spirit, in your body, is the fire. He came to bring judgment. And Jesus said, for judgment I came into this world, so that those who do not see may see. And that, thank God he said that. Because there are a lot of people who are doing wrong stuff, and they think they are getting away. And many of you are, you need to amend yourself so that you can conform. Don't conform, because God is going to bring them to judgment. He's going to bring them to judgment. There is no nation where anybody can commit crime, do whatever he likes, whether crime or physical crime. Once they are caught, they will be brought to judgment. They will be put in jail. Go to hell in Jesus' name. Amen. He came to be king. Number 21. He came to be king. John 18:37. Therefore, Pilate said, you say correctly that I am a king. For this I have been born, and for this I have come into the world. Hallelujah. He came to bear to the truth. He came to bear witness to the truth. Number 22. For this I have come into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone is of the truth. Hears my voice. John, he came into the world to be a faithful high priest. Be a faithful high priest, that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to 24. He came to destroy the works of the devil. The Son of God appeared for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. 28. Only as a human being could he die, and only by dying could he break the power of the devil, who had the power of death. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. Now judgment is upon this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. John, this world is coming, and he has nothing in him. John 14:30. I know I can't teach you that one. You know that one. You see people praying, so Lord, I bind for that. He came to destroy the works of the devil. I command every sickness in your body, every arthritis, every affliction, in your name of Jesus Christ. Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. Every work of the devil in your life, I command them destroyed in the name of Jesus. I destroy them by the power in the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Number 25, he came to send a sword. Cannot resonate with, but Jesus, this is not about what to resonate with. It's about why he came. And he made it clear. Don't imagine, oh, I came to bring a sword. I've come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her. Matthew 10 verse 34. I was watching a video clip recently of a woman that set up his what? His husband. You hire to kill his husband. All the things the man had is your own. I don't know the story. But how do you act? You know, when many people that are ill-treating their children, killing their husband, killing their wife. Oh, accept Jesus. Amen. Number 26, he came to bear our sins. He came, Peter 2:24 is talking about the process by which your sins were cleansed away. Number 27, so he came to provide a pattern of holy living for Christians. Today, my son-in-law preached in identification and living the lifestyle of God. I was so touched by this young man. I told him, if it's me, 60 years, preaching age, 20-something, you know, sanctification is the key word. Live a holy. Jesus came to show us a pattern of holy life. Samuel said, Who of any misdemeanor. Who can accuse me of stealing one thing or the other? Joshua of the Lord. Hebrews said, without holiness you cannot see God. Why do we come to church, pray and do? Please, let's live a sanctified life. Let's live holy life. That's where you can see and pray. It's good to watch this video. But if you are not living holy, your prayer is going nowhere. He said, my ears are not blocked, but your sin has constituted a blockage between me and you. May God help us in Jesus' name. Number 28, to heal the brokenhearted. I like that. Are you right now? Receive divine healing. Receive divine healing. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Sent me to bind the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to heal the brokenhearted. Don't be depressed. Don't commit suicide. Jesus came to heal you. You are. You shall be healed. I speak healing to your heart. Whatever depression, situation, divine healing. Receive divine healing in the name of Jesus. The name of number 29, to bring deliverance to the captive. More on deliverance. But that's, it says, in Mount Zion shall be holiness and deliverance. And the people shall possess their. Jesus came to bring deliverance to you. Receive it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Number 31, to give you peace. I love this. Are you a Christian? Don't let anything negotiate your peace away from you. How is he intending to do all these things? Through the instrumentality of the Holy Spirit. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world come the world. I thank you for listening. I pray God blesses you in Jesus' name. Don't negotiate one thing. You want to give you peace. Jesus said, I am come from heaven and I'm going to heaven. When you matter, it matters. No matter how long you live here, you're going to leave this place. Where do you go? Somebody came, gone there. He has a plan to take you there. John 14 verse 1, I have, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me, my precious. If you have not told, I will have told you. I go to prepare his place for you. Why did he come from heaven? To take you back there. Trinity, use it now. Do what it takes now to make sure one day when you close your eyes, you will not just be buried. The angels you for a time like this. Thank you for sharing with us why you came, where you came from. Bless your people in Jesus' name. My name is Pastor, by the grace of God, Christ Apostolic Church, Bethel, Toronto, and we worship at 94K Hard Drive. If you are in Toronto, you want to be part of us, you are welcome. By the grace of God, we experience daily miracles. Come and be part of it. Love you. God bless you. Until we meet again. Amen. God bless you. Bye.